So my first question is, probably you can answer in three bullets each, is what has been the biggest change in digital advertising you've seen in the last 5 years in terms of overall ecosystem, spends, or whichever way you'd like to talk about it, starting with you, Tushar.
Yeah, so I spent more than 10 years in this business, so I think one of the key changes I see is, can you hear me? I think, is it clear? Yeah. So I think no more I hear the question from client that why internet, I think that question has vanished, but it moved to now next level of evolution and how and what. So I think that's a mindset change which started happening, and that's a positive thing. And if you look from a overall industry perspective, I think the social is another phenomena which is. Social is another phenomena which has changed lots of things in last few years. And I'm sort of pretty bullish on the mobile, and next change is going to come
you
from
use
there.
The hand mic.
So if I had to say three things is changing mindset of marketer, social and mobile as a three trends.
I think about when I started Pinstrom about 9 years ago, digital advertising, I mean, you used to have the mainland advertising budget, and below that was an asterisk called everything else, and within the asterisk was an indented sub-asterisk called digital. Right?
Sure.
So digital has moved from that to being part of the main media plan. I think that's the big change I've seen. I think when I start, about 8-9 years ago, the entire market was 200-300 crores.
Yeah.
Today, I think it's about 2,500 crores.
Advertising 2,200.
Digital is about 2,500 crores.
Yeah.
I also think now, in those days, you used to have the VP marketing, and you had the various media buyers and marketing managers, and the junior MBA tattoo was given the job of doing digital.
Correct.
Today, the senior guy, you know, right to the top, is interested in doing digital. So I think both in amount of money and amount of importance that's being given, and especially now today I'm seeing for youth brands that we work with, more and more pretty much people are saying, you know what, TV isn't teaching these guys, for youth brands is, let's especially go digital. So it's really become a C-suite, you know, a CXO, CEO, CMO level activity. It used to not be that 4-5 years ago.
Correct. So I think both of the guests have made that point. Now, there is a lot of talk in the West about digital being inclusive in the strategy, right from the conceptualization of big brand campaigns, very early stages. You know, if you hire a celebrity and you put in millions of dollars behind it, you build interactivity through online right from a very early stage. India, the little example we could see was the Nescafe campaign of Deepika Padukone, wherein right from the first ad, the Facebook Connect was there, but not in the best manner possible. So on digital being inclusive in the strategy right from the word go, you think it's happening? I have 3-4 lines of questions in that.
Sure. So. I think it started happening, but still there are early days in terms of, so what you call is digital as inclusion or social by design and stuff like that. People started thinking about digital and then started building campaigns. So we take a recent spike win of Kisanpur or Nescafe or Titan. So those kind of brands started thinking that. But I would say still it's a tip of iceberg. We have a long way to go. And there are lots of lip service to that area than the real action. So the trend is positive, but there's a long way to go in that direction.
So I think while there's certainly a trend, I think what's really stopping this from happening is that the traditional advertising business is built into what's called the creative business and what's called the media buying business, right? So there's a creative agency and there's a media agency. In digital, there's no such thing called creative media. Both of them work together.
Correct.
So what really happens is typically, you know, the creative agency works in strategy and the media agency pretty much then implements it in media. And digital firms, either they benefit it as a media digital firm or a creative digital firm, and hence, you know, usually it's the digital media firms more than digital creative firms, and hence they really don't get that early view. So one of the big things that we've fought for a long time is that we have to be seen as pretty much at the higher level than, you know, in fact, even your traditional advertising creative and the traditional advertising media buying firm, because that's the only way that you can impact strategy right from the beginning. In fact, with several of our new launches that we're doing for one of India's largest FMCG brands, It's interesting that the idea came from the digital agency, the execution came from the digital agency, the video production came from the digital agency, it's being adapted into television and adapted into print by the mainline agencies.
Correct.
So I think that change, more and more of that will happen, but all of us in the digital business have to kick ourselves out and, you know, break that entire thing that there's creative agencies and there's media agencies. That's a remnant of the television era. That's kind of dying, dead, gone, and that's irrelevant in this era. We have to really break that for us to be able to truly be seen as somebody who can influence strategy at the top level.
Just to add what Masha said, now many brands started looking at the ideas agency, so it's no more digital or no more TV media agency. So you are ideas agency, you come up with the idea and bring it to life. And that's where the real integration starts.
But, you know, as agencies who are holding big clients, especially Group M, you know, does it become some kind of prerogative for the digital arm of Group M to evangelize this? How has been the experience with you? Do you push clients that, hey, you know, the digital's got to be inclusive and we've got 10 ideas before you hire a celebrity, or you can hire a celebrity based on an idea?
Of course, celebrity is one aspect, but I think overall integration story is pretty much part of it. And so, like any typical agency, we also follow a certain planning process. And what we call is a multi-screen planning or a device-neutral planning kind of thing. So, where the entire process force planner or strategist to think integrated manner and medium-neutral manner, and then they build the plan.
Sure.
So I have a different view of this, you know, again an artifact of the era we live in, which was in, actually perhaps created by his current employer and my past employer, the WPP who I used to work with once upon a time, was the fact that the creative agencies primarily work on fees, the media agencies work on commissions, fees and commissions have come down, so creative agencies actually, if you look at the balance sheet, actually work on, let's say, undeclared margins from television commercial production. While media agencies work on what's called ORCs, overriding commissions, which are, you can call them kickbacks, whatever, agency value bonus fractions that come from media, right? So if you take that, you can understand why digital has grown so slowly. Two of the largest digital, you know, the three digital, largest digital properties in India are Google, YouTube, and Facebook. All three are transparent, none of them do kickbacks. So hence, there's no incentive for large media agencies to suggest Google or Facebook because they don't give kickbacks, while a Sony gives kickback and a Apple gives kickbacks and everybody else in the media world, Times of India gives kickbacks, right? They're called agency commissions. So for the longest time, it's been a big fight to come all the way up. At Pinchman, for example, we do media buying, but we do have a very stated policy that zero overriding commissions. Correct. There is no undeclared kickback, nothing whatsoever, all money goes back to the client. And the second thread that's really going to come out here is on the television production part. A typical you know, creative agency television production commercial, television commercial will cost you a crore. Doing the same thing digital will cost you 3 or 4 lakhs.
Correct.
Pretty much the same quality, full HD and so on and so forth. So you can imagine, I mean, the huge amount of fat that is in there. So today a client is choosing to say, well, I'll put 30 lakhs and do 7 commercials on digital and they're good enough, I'll take them to TV rather than I put 80 lakhs and do one for TV. So we're finding both the revenue models which the old world agencies were built by are really now coming under siege. And I think this is really the time the clients are also sitting back and saying, why do I have to necessarily, you know, give in to this particular, why do I have to change myself to the industry's revenue model? Let me figure out if there's a different way of doing things. So I think there's a huge transformation going on here. There's revenue pressures at large agencies. There's opportunities for smaller agencies. I think it's a great time to be here.
One of the questions, related question, yeah, please.
Yes, I would just pick up a point because I slightly disagree on this point, and of course,
Mahesh is
this was a reality when Google wouldn't be Google or Facebook wouldn't have existed, right? So basically, media players grow on their merit, and WP as a group is the largest consumer of Google, and India also we are largest agency partner of Google, and this is well documented fact.
So it could be 3 times the size.
So and if you look at a group of client media mix also, we would be more progressive than even industry in terms of percentage of digital spend of our set of client vis-a-vis any other agency. So I sort of don't buy into that point, but sort of same time respect to you.
He always disagrees with me.
I'll try and get this question. There is there's a friend of mine, he's FMS alumnus, my batch, and he is one of the very senior marketers in FMCG. So he told me, here somebody we are investing in digital, but I don't think we have a strategy. I don't hear much strategy. We're just investing in digital, we want to be there, but he was not convinced that people coming to him are able to show him the strategy. I mean, do you want to?
So maybe I can take that, right? You know, I think it's a very, very relevant criticism of our business. Very often, what's really happened is we have two types of people in the business. We have lots of young people, young digital blood, and maybe many of us don't have that sound marketing fundamentals, right? And we want to go up and talk to the client. The client is out there saying, you know, no, don't tell me about CPC, don't tell me about CPM, tell me about how this works for my brand, right? And no matter what words you throw at him, it's not going to work because you have to learn to speak his language. I mean, now over the last few years, we're seeing a few more people who are seasoned in the traditional agency world, who for whatever reason have decided that this is pretty much where they want to move. And now more and more so, they're able to come and talk to the client in the client's language, right? Now this is becoming more and more important, especially in the realm of social media. It's actually very easy. I come from a traditional, I used to be at Ogilvy Gray and so on, so from traditional agency background, I used to also run a television channel. It's actually much easier to do stuff in television than in digital. For example, I mean, especially in the sense of when it comes to something like Facebook. What is it that you are on Facebook? You know, everybody understands that in Facebook, it's not the number of fans that matter, it's the engagement that matters. Everybody also understands that things that make engagement matter are shares, tags, likes, comments, and so on and so forth. But the interesting thing is when you're a brand, you can't share, you can't like, you can't tag, you can't comment. So essentially what Facebook has done is taken away all the you know, barriers of engagement away from you. So you have to sit back and say, I have to make my audience engage with each other, share with each other, like to each other, and comment to each other. Now, that means you have to move from, say, thinking, I am the advertiser, that is the medium, that's where I talk, to a point where you say, I am the provider of the stage, and the audience is on the stage, and they interact on the stage. That entire change of shift in mindset is very, very difficult because that didn't even happen in the traditional agency either. So doing strategy on digital is even more difficult. Right. Because you have to change the mindset from I am the broadcaster and there's an audience to saying I am the platform and my audience are the participants in the platform. It is like we are the stage providers, we are the backdrop providers, and the audience speaks on it rather than we are the people in front speaking on it. It's a huge mind shift change that has to happen. So strategy is especially difficult when it comes to digital.
Tushar, in a 100 million market, just extending on this question, what confidence do you give to a client in terms of the money spent is really strategic? I mean, just adding to the question.
Just I get there, I was adding to what Mahesh has said. I think in terms of digital, when you talk about strategy, it needs a slightly longer term view compared to what happens on TV and other medium, because marketers are very tuned to thinking of a campaign mindset.
Sure.
While in case of digital, it's a more sustained, more long term. And if you dig deeper in many of the brands, those kind of confidence to invest for a long term, maybe whatever, 2, 3, 5, 10 years kind of vision, very few brands have got today. So that's another constraint in terms of creating long-term programs around digital. Coming back to the number part, I think we are reaching a stage where numbers are becoming irrelevant. So it's an accepted fact that there's a sizable number exists. And if you go to any marketer, I think they are well aware that YouTube features in the top 10 TV or Yahoo homepage is as big as like leading English newspaper. So I think number, we are crossing that barrier where people are worried about number.
It's about actually changing the measure. You've gone from saying, you know, what's your cost per reach of 1,000 to what's your cost per engaging 1,000, which is, you know, 7 levels higher than reach. It's difficult to prove that engagement happening on other media actually.
Like overall, you know, campaign mix, sometimes, you know, we launch online, pure online products. So we've thought about launching products with only social and PR, some online PR, some offline PR. We do some amount of reputation management for some products. But I know that's not a practical thing for all the brands to do. But in your perspective, are social and search taking the, you know, bigger meat when we look at 2000 crore industry? Or is Google display also display, and the real-time bidding is display, retargeting is display? How do you look at display versus social versus search in campaigns?
So if I can answer that, if I start up and say, if there's a startup out there, and I put a separate hat on where, you know, I've held back a few startups. And if you look at companies like a Redbus, or look at companies like a Carvalho, or, you know, these are companies that have built large brands and huge revenue streams without really spending in what you would call traditional media. And largely, they've only done digital. In digital, they've done search, social. Today, if you ask me, it's more than search, social. I keep talking to clients and saying the four pillars of digital are search, social, video, and mobile. And this is really where, if you figure out what your role is in search, social, video, and mobile, and the fifth is the site, of course, at the middle of it all. These are the five things that you need to figure out on what you need to do to get ahead. Against all this, if you sit back and say, okay, fine, where does display come in? I think display is probably a little less important. I think Tushar may disagree, but if I look at, for example, revenues in India, out of the 2,500 crores, Google is at about 1,500 crores. Oh. I think YouTube and Facebook are at 150 crores each. And nobody else is even at 100 crores. In fact, the only two companies to cross the 100 crore mark other than Google, two brands are YouTube and Facebook, right? So even Yahoo or others are not there yet at that point. So display hasn't yet grown. And the problem is, maybe we have undersold, you know, we in the media industry have undersold it. I used to remember last year, I don't know if Tushar can add to it, the amount of digital used to be sold at, I think, you know, 10 cents CPM or 5 rupees CPM, some ridiculous rates used to get on display. I think we have to figure out a way to hold the rate up and not, you know, pilot high, sell it cheap and go through a network to be able to do what you want.
Sure. Tushar?
Yeah, so, I think when we classify basically video and display, we put under one bucket compared to search. So if you look at it in Google also, there's a huge amount of display component in Google. And if you look at YouTube as a property, this is growing at multifold year on year. So that's going to be a pretty important part as far as the brand side of advertising story goes. Yes. There's another performance side of advertising story where, of course, our social will play, but brand side display is going to be a critical component besides social. And we see good traction there, especially in the video area.
Sure.
So one of the constraints I see, there is a lack of content in the Indian environment, especially in the video side.
So I had 3-4 questions I would like to cover very quickly, so if you could briefly answer them.
Sure.
So how do you see a DSP or a real-time bidding agencies owning this kind of platform and then servicing? Do you see potential in that very quickly, both of you?
So real-time bidding is more like a data-driven story, so it's the way yesterday's of advertising is demographic targeting and stuff like that. Current and future is going to be behavior targeting, and that's where data is going to play a critical part, and that's where the role of DSP is going to come in terms of trading and managing inventory and giving more targeted audiences to advertisers.
Display side platforms, supply side platforms, you know, these are all tools. They're not going to be mainline firms. You know, from a brand manager's point of view, it's merely a way of executing a media plan.
Right.
It's not going to influence the media.
Right. Last question is, how do you see this agency buyouts, AKQA and a lot of smaller agencies in India taken over by bigger agencies? How do you see the ecosystem changing? Does it help overall spends? How does it work out?
You've been buying agencies?
Not for quite some time, but yeah, W feels
shouldn't be a Bollywood developer.
Yeah. So I think it's a catch-up game, and it's also a continuous process, and especially large groups are also into market share kind of play. So from that perspective, it's important to acquire capability, and there is a merit in terms of getting skill set, merit in terms of client relationship, and new technology and processes. So that's a part of evolution for any of the group.
I read Martin Sorrell saying 40% this year they are expecting out of digital revenues.
Yeah, so digital is huge amount of focus, and that's where the growth is happening, and that's where the future is going to lie.
Sure.
So, I think one of the things that we manage in India is compared to many other geographies in the world, the top 3, 4, 5 agencies in India over the last 8, 9 years have actually been independent shops,
sure,
not been group shops.
100%. Yeah.
So actually, it's been a pretty good thing, and maybe it accidentally happened because we chose a performance marketing route that many group companies were not willing to take the risk to do that. So today, you know, these are companies that are being bought. At some point, you know, if the price is right, everybody is going to be for sale. So I do know that. I think probably Princeton is the last one of the last few independent agencies standing out there. And that's primarily because once upon a time we used to fear that, oh my God, if we don't become part of a group, we won't get a client. You know, that's not true anymore. Clients don't hold any allegiances. They're happy to go to whoever provides the best service. So at some point you will find that the digital agency houses will pay a decent amount of money to buy an agency that they want.
Is it cartelization?
Cartelization. It's hard to, you know, digital is so much about ideas. It's not really about buying power.
Absolutely.
No matter what. So you can create a cartel, at least bright people will go break off and start another agency, and get some accounts. So I think it's extremely difficult to create a cartoon in consulting.
Maybe yeah, what our business is all
it's
about.
It's pretty evolving in early stage of medium, so it's a relatively early entry barriers.
Yeah. I think it's a great idea. So let's open it for questions.
Sure.
Please.
My name is Ona. The question was, we've spoken about search, social, video, mobile. In terms of online, how much of this is driven by on-ground location events, you know, saying that, you know, you have an event, there's a lot of content which gets generated, events which happen, which creates a lot of buzz online, on mobile, and then again, timeline again till the next event and then close. Is there any value in that?
So if I can, I think, you know, the location is a layer on top of each. You can be location-based search, location-based video, location-based mobile and all of that stuff, right? So to me, location-based is just another, you know, fact. It's just another criteria. You do a check mark and then you buy your advertising.
I mean, events below the line.
I'm not sure what the connection, what the connection, maybe I don't get it. So below the line events in the connection to digital.
Right, saying that today more brands are interested a lot with digital mobile and their other reach is actually on location and below the line events which happen. This is where
I would say it's other way around where activation on ground events are used as a feeder to social media and other activity to amplify that. So basically there is a closer integration between activation and digital. To amplify what is happening in ground and then take it to next level.
So I'm even more extreme. I believe the future is going to be one where there's going to be online and on ground. That's about it. The answer is 42. Oh, you haven't asked the question
yet. I haven't asked the question yet.
Okay.
So I'm trying to understand how this space is going to change going forward because there's been a focus on performance and numbers so far online. That, the way I see it, is doesn't allow more content to be created because you're so driven by that CPM, that CPC. Do we see that changing? Because as far as I'd like there to be 100 niche sites that are trying to monetize and not necessarily banking on doing SEO or black hat SEO and that sort of quality content is not getting created because there isn't from an advertising perspective that focus on backing quality content. Am I right? Am I wrong? What are your views on this? So,
can I take a shot at it? I think if many entrepreneurs I meet, Nikhil, who really are interested in building great content, but they're really not as interested in monetizing that content the way that they have to or they should, right? So if you spend a lot of time building content but don't spend time thinking about how to make money out of it, you will fall for the second best option, which is you will go to a media network or you will sell on CPM or and then, you know, if your yields will plummet because you will go down to 20 rupees CPM average, 30 rupees CPM average. Or you can pull it the other way back up and say, no, I'm going to hold this tight and make sure I can make as much money out of this possible. So I'll give you an example of one of my own companies, Afax, or another one, Sportskeeda. These are companies which have built large, good, high quality, you'd agree, content bases and significant revenue lines. And for example, I can tell you that the average yield on Afax is about, and I know Srikant will kill me for saying this, is more than 700 rupees CPM, while the average yield in the market is 20 rupees CPM. You've simply done that by protecting the site and saying, I am not going to sell through these third parties, I'm not going to sell it below this price. So if you figure out how to sell it, it's the same thing. I mean, if you have a site and you don't want to sell it, you go to a third party, they'll sell it high and they'll sell it cheap. But you hold it very tight, you charge a high amount of money from it, for it, advertisers will understand the value and you will get the money you deserve. You have to put as much effort into thinking monetization as you think content.
Okay, so just taking on that money you deserve piece, right? What about the issue of the payment cycles? Because that's something which is not allowing, again, businesses to start from what I've seen.
So,
if someone starts, someone is bootstrapping a content business and it takes them 6 to 8 months to get their first payment from an agency and then the agency wants a kickback for it, this thing needs to change. I'm just wondering what will it take, one, to change the time cycle, and two, change this kickback situation. You know, what's the solution here?
I think you can talk about the kickback part a little better than I, right? I think the best thing I can advise I can give is go straight to the client and say, listen, dude, I have to get paid in 28 days or my people don't get food. right? And the client is always willing to pay. It is the agency in the middle that's trying to make the float. That's trying to say, I'll get the client's payment in 45 days, I'll pay you in 135 days. During that 90 days, I'm going to make 2.5% a month, I make another 7.5% a month. And that's the CFO-driven agency. So if you're able to fight that out, and nothing can fight it out unless you focus as much on monetization.
So I think payment has also to do with the transaction management process and stuff like that. So for example, kind of scale we run, it's optimistically it takes a 60-day kind of timeline. And if you have for example, Google runs very clean system, online system, I can go and generate invoice and stuff like that.
So who gets paid in 60 days?
Yeah, so those kind of guys are getting paid where they are running very clean system, right? And you are running a larger system where the money is moving also with the TV and other medium. So, for example, IVF is on 75 days. So TV money moves at 75-day cycle. So those are the cycle agencies are tuned to work with. And that's the cycle money moves. So we are part of it currently. And we have to live with that limitation in terms of money cycle. Because there's a billing, there's a documentation providing, and there's lots of manual process currently attached to it. So that's a part and parcel, and I think we need to.
So I would disagree. You don't have to live with it. Go to the client, change the rules. If these rules don't allow you to work, change the rules.
No, so that's what we've done. But I'm looking at the larger ecosystem and the PIM and the way that works.
And I think IMO and AAAF are also discussing to resolve some of these issues. So there is an industry level issue.
The IMO will discuss it in 2018.
That's stagnated, right? So
yeah. 2018.
So IBF has managed to resolve this, IMS has managed to resolve. If we come together as an industry, we'll be able to resolve also.
So what will it take is what I'm asking. Yes.
8 years.
What?
Okay.
8 years.
8 years.
Yeah, I got.
So for example, Google don't talk about it, right? Google has a very strict policy norms, and then people pay up.
The thing is that no one has the might of Google behind
them. Yeah. Google did that even when it was only a 100 crore company in India. It does it today, 1500 crores. He did it, it put its foot down back then. So it took a publisher with the right principle. Google always never had the might. It started doing 5 crores in 2002.
I also had the right processes with the sort of right mindset.
And Google forced everybody, and the same Google that, you know, they had trouble paying everybody else in 75 days, they had to pay Google in the time that Google wants. Right? So I think in agencies' claims of inflexibility should be taken with about, you know, large amounts of salt. I think, you know, push comes to shove, hold the gun to the head, you'll get the money.
So it's time that the websites formed a cartel of some sort then, I guess.
More than cartel, it's a sort of industry body. So there is a structure way to do it, so.
Because there's a real problem. The big guys, you know, are straight up. So YouTube, Facebook, three big guys, are already straight, no kickbacks, no nothing, whatever it is. Everybody else is so small that if you put them together, they don't actually even match half the size of those first three.
Correct.
That's the problem. If you take Google and Facebook and YouTube, and the industry outside that is 800 crores, and these three are 1700 crores. Right? So the thing is that we aren't beginning yet, but certainly if you're strong enough, powerful enough, have a backbone, even if you're 1 lakh, you'll get that 1 lakh on time. You don't even need to form a cartel. I mean, somebody will break the cartel. The weakest link in the cartel will break it and say, "Okay, I'll give you 90 days.
But that also adds on to another question, maybe from the publisher side. We don't see enough long tail, we don't see enough grassroots blogging. A lot of my counterparts in USA say, why don't you launch through grassroots blogging? They say, it's not very strong. We don't have those recipe sites, cooking sites. They're very small.
Actually, you'd be very, very surprised. I mean, today, I know there are clients who very clearly, our clients are saying, can you give me 100 food bloggers?
Absolutely.
Can you give me 100 tech bloggers?
Yeah.
And they're able to do that.
The demand is very much there.
They're able to do that. We maintain something called the India Influencer Ranking of 6,000-7,000 people. We're able to figure out who are the top 100 food bloggers and stuff. But the fact is, we have to break the entire overriding commission and feedback on TV production business. You have to break that nexus. For you to be able to go to the next and say, I'm not going to do work the old way, I'm going to do work the new way. So actually what's holding us back is the old way of doing business. And I do predict that 5 years from now, you will not have overriding commissions, you will not have, you know, TV production kickbacks. The way that they have ruined Indian industry for the last 25 years will not happen.
Sure.
I think, again, sort of, Mahesh, I just keep agreeing because we are going back to the I'm just highlighting this point because we keep going back to the same point.
Hey, look, you guys have 300 crores on overriding commissions, right?
So industry has moved to a different level where there are auditors, where auditors each places and their client demands and offers.
Yeah, you know, somebody who says, when you ask him, what is 2 plus 2, he says, what do you want it to be? Right? I'm putting
sure. Nice. If you don't want to believe, then there is 10 way to
question this. But
industry has moved to a different level of transparency, and it's pretty.
So there are degrees of transparency.
I think we will take the next question if there's one.
Questions?
Yes. All right, so no more questions.
Can I have, make one remark? I mean, here's an appeal, it's not an appeal. So I've been talking to a bunch of people, and my sense is that this 2,500 crore Indian ad industry will become about 6,000 crores in 3 years' time. My problem I see is that Google, your YouTube will take about 3,500 to 4,000 crores of it, right? Or maybe 4,500 crores of it. It still leaves all Indian sites all put together at only 1,500 crores. This is based on my view of what the sites are and what, you know, some of the people's view that I respect a lot. Where are our sites? Where are the content sites out here that can take this money? Why is it that with everything, 70% of the money will still go to those two companies? It went today, why will it go 3 years from now? If this business is doubling, why should it only go to Google and Facebook? And that's a question I have to ask you. Why, where are the entrepreneurs? Where are the sites? Where are the businesses? The clients are willing to advertise. You would agree with that? The clients are willing to buy outside Google and Facebook.
Absolutely, yeah.
Right? Do you see any, don't you see that it's an issue?
Yeah. Yeah, in fact, there's another point which I was discussing before the session. So if you look at the TV industry, what made TV big is investment like ABC, Big Boss and stuff like that. So there's no content investment going from the Indian company which is eventually differentiated or demand that kind of premium.
I think it's a great example. TV and print is a great example. We don't have money going to these one or two multinationals. Why is it only in online that 70% of the dollar, 70 cents of every dollar goes to these two companies?
But just checking this, Tushar, do you feel that Google is going to go from 1,200 to 4,000 crore share?
Yeah, so Google will have lion's share in the market.
Okay.
That's definitely there, unless there is a strong local ecosystem emerge.
And you know, all this Google revenue through AdSense travels into Indian sites only. Do you take that into account?
You know, how much do you get? I mean, depending on the size of the site, you will get between 20% and 40% of the revenue. So I'm not double counting the revenue. Mm-hmm. It's revenue that Google's earned, and
generally Google pays out around 60-65% of revenue.
It depends on how big a site you are. If you're small, it pays you 20%, but big it pays you 80%.
Yeah.
It pays in that margin.
Yeah.
But should we have larger sites?
No, it's a
television.
Television.
Look at the Indian companies, whether it's a Z or a Sony. Or whatever style. I mean, these successes are Indian. Times of India, Hindustan Times, these successes are Indian.
Correct.
Where are the equivalents in the digital system? I can tell you the clients are ready for it. Would you agree?
Yeah, and currently if you look at digital ecosystem is more aggregating and curating content, not the original content so much. And once we get into that area, then it will start differentiating.
Yeah, I think,
it requires huge investments.
I just add to this discussion because we had a debate on Twitter a month ago when we were discussing whether most journalism is traditionally being advertiser supported or not. So I think you made mention of, say, Hindustan Times or Times of India on the TV side. But if you look at television, for example, television news in particular, which I know well, initially all TV news was not advertiser funded, especially in the US, because as part of the FCC license, you had to give 1 hour networks for public service advertising. So it's after about 20 years of non-commercial news, but you had a CNN which got the first sort of commercial thing going. So it took 20 years, or even for print, the early print guys were doing it for, national service, freedom struggle. It was never a business venture in the early days. I think with internet, the problem is that the VCs have come before the entrepreneurs. So today a content entrepreneur from day one is doing it with CPM in mind and not with, the larger ideas of building audiences and, something beyond just commercial.
But that's not the VC's fault. Right?
No, absolutely not. I'm just saying it's a phenomenon. I'm not saying it's anyone's fault. That's the content problem as far as entrepreneurs are concerned. When you say why are there not so many sites and why is Media Mama, even after 5 years, just one among very few quality content sites in the country.
No, I think that's because probably, and I'm not brown-nosing Nikhil because this is his event. He's got a backbone. He stands up. He says no to what he doesn't agree with. There are not any sites doing that. He sets his price and says, that's my price, and there's not enough sites doing that. There's nothing special about doing it. many of the sites do that, some of my own industries do that, right? It's not, whether they're invested by VC or not is irrelevant. So EFAX was VC invested right from the beginning, Media Nomad probably was not. So it doesn't matter, I don't think it's that. I think it really comes down to your makeup as an entrepreneur. Are you here for the long run? And the second thing is, I can tell you this, it costs far more to do a TV news channel, far more to do a print newspaper than to do a website. It costs far.
If you make even a 1% margin on a newspaper business, it still might be 10 crores, which will pay for, you know, say 20 journalists. If you make even a 50% margin on internet, unfortunately, it's 5 lakhs, which is difficult.
That's not true. If you sell it the other way, if you sell it right, that doesn't have to be true. I can certainly tell you, you know, AFAX has 200,000 readers.
Right.
And it's got more revenues than probably 90% of the sites have in India.
Right.
It's only got 200,000 readers.
AFAX, it's taken a while, right? It's 10 years now?
So what? I mean, so what's the hurry? Startup time, Hindustan Times took time.
Yeah.
There is time.
I think the problem is that everyone has decided that the only way you can make money in content is to go that whole demand media, content farm, massive scale with computer generated content model.
I disagree.
Yeah. The organic model is just too much hard work.
There's no easy money here, right?
So I just wanted to get a sense of Tushar and Mahesh. You guys had mentioned that the need for content properties. I think Tushar had mentioned it. How much of your budgets were you actually allocating, and what are the advertisers saying? Would they allocate budgets to niche content sites? I mean, it's one thing to say that you want more content so that you can advertise on it. But even when it comes up, how long does it take for the agency to recognize it and really put money there? So if
Tushar. So basically, advertisers will be going to follow audiences, right? So if you get the right kind of stickiness and right sort of
looking beyond numbers is what I was talking about. Looking beyond mere numbers, like 200,000.
So even looking beyond
10,000.
See, I mean, the reason 200,000 is big is because in the advertising and media industry, 200,000 is almost 100% coverage, right? So in that industry, it's a large audience. But I can certainly tell you that there are two kinds of advertiser spends that we are seeing in digital. One is the regular media buy. I want to buy media. The second is, can I engage with the evangelist? Can I engage with the blogger? Can I still put money behind, you know, not necessarily unethically, but can I put money behind marketing? So for example, if I have to launch the iPhone 5 in India 2 months from now, who are the 50 niche sites that can write about it? How can I work with them to create a package that will mean money for them without disrupting their ethical considerations in the slightest? And there are people who want to do that. And I would say that, you know, out of a budget, up to 5, 10, 15% would easily be set aside just for that.
I don't think anyone's trying to do that without impinging on the ethical and editorial.
I can tell you enough are doing that. Certainly enough brands in India are saying, look, I know that I don't want to be seen as I bought that guy out. You know, after the recent Samsung fiasco and stuff, a lot of brands are very, very...
So what kind of brand you are chasing? I think most of the guys end up chasing the same 200 guys. So that's where the problem starts. And if you look at the internet advertiser base, I would say next to print only, so in terms of larger base. So there's a large set of advertiser available. It can be broad based compared to what available to TV and other medium.
Mahesh, isn't there a very fundamental issue of, you know, local language for content in India? You know, India never had a local language computing environment, nor did it have enough, you know, local language content. But if you look at the next, you know, next 100 million people, they're not going to come to internet with a local language.
That's the 1,000 kilo elephant in the room, right? I worry about that. In 1999-2000, I funded a company called Webdunia. Mm-hmm. It's still struggling today, 12 years later.
Sure.
Right? But problem is that we are at about 140 million internet users. We are only about 260, 270 million English speakers.
Yeah.
How the hell does the industry go beyond that? Right?
Correct.
And the problem is manifold. We can certainly blame anybody else. So today, for example, one of the things that aided in English becoming de facto language is that there's only one keyboard called the QWERTY keyboard. In Devanagari, there are 8 official keyboards. In Tamil, you know, there are 7 official keyboards, all sanctioned by the government.
Yeah,
so nobody is bothered to learn how to write. At the second level, you know, my driver, he has to figure out how to use this content. So I think people will win if they figure out, he's not stupid. Just because he doesn't know language doesn't mean that the audience is stupid or down market. You have to figure out using pictures, words, audio, video, numbers, but without necessarily saying, I will have you write per governor. Right? Mm-hmm. So we will go through a period. Our transition to a large internet economy will not be as easy as China's, where everybody follows one language. We don't have that advantage.
Yeah.
So it's really going to be stilted. It's going to be problematic. I don't even answer. You know,
I think maybe, you know, touch is probably the solution. Maybe, you know, if touch picks up.
So
that picks up maybe.
I think video is another trend which has got more universal language. So that's a